that's Shooting Star. It has, it's almost petaled, has deep lobes on the flower, and it's near white. This is not the original Shooting Star, but it looks pretty much like it. This is one, another recent introduction, and I think Andy Brand, the nursery manager, came up with the name Firecracker. The original plant that was found of this type was named by Clarence Tao in, I guess, South Carolina, Tightwad, because the flowers never open. This is one that was actually found here in Connecticut that has good, nice pink buds. If we're going to actually make a cross, we'll use this plant, what we'd call the female, the one that'll produce the seed. So I'm not going to go too far here, but I would remove some of the open flowers nearby the one that we're going to make the cross on. And then what we want to do is, where we set up the flowers to be cross-pollinated, we want to remove the flowers right nearby. We don't want to attract bumblebees, okay? And then we'd have to remove all the open flowers. So I have not too many flowers to work with here. Usually we want like 10. I take off all the open ones and maybe the small ones. And then we call it emasculation. We remove the cup, well, the fused petals, corolla, goes by different names. And these stamens in here, I'm removing them at the same time. Those are the pollen-bearing structures. So it cannot self-pollinate. And we're removing the visual attractant, the landing platform for the bumblebee. So if we have 10 flowers here all set up and no open flowers, the bumblebees won't be attracted. And so we don't have to put a bag over it or protect it with netting. So I would set up 10 flowers like this. And then a day later, when this is elongated a little bit more, the pistil has gotten tacky or sticky on the surface here. Then I would take the flower that has the anthers as our male parent, and we're going to pick out an anther. So if I grab that, there'll be a little pollen, typically, in those anthers. I can see the pollen on there, on that one. And it clumps together. We put it on the tip there, and that pollen will germinate, tubes grow down, and fertilization occurs in the that green pod, the ovary down there. That's where the seed develops. We'll put a tag on here so we don't lose the identity and have a record of what the cross was, and harvest the seed in late October. We took that pink-budded, tightwad-like plant, the one where the flowers never open, crossed it with Raspberry Glow, which is a very rich colored mountain laurel, and just within the last year we named one Forever Red. What we're trying to do now is clonally propagate this. It's very difficult to root from cuttings, so the process is they take a bud and sterilize it in the laboratory and on nutrient broth and auxins and hormones. They try to get them to multiply, and it's the initial step is a difficult one, but once they get it going, then they can produce thousands of little shoots, and those can be rooted and grown on to replicate this plant as many times as you want. Why do I like mountain laurel? There's so much variation. Flowers have such great architecture, you know, in bud, they're really exquisite. Then finding all this variation, and I say finding it, what I mean is people have told me of plants that they have found, whether nurserymen or amateurs, botanic gardens, and pulling all this together and learning how some of these traits are inherited, developing new attractive plants for the garden. I mean, it's just been great to take this from the beginning, making controlled crosses and be with it for 50 years, how often do you have that opportunity? So, yeah, what's not to like?